In this video, I'm going to discuss slots or elongated holes. I recently did a live stream about this, but I want to go in some more detail in an edited format. So what I'm talking about behind me is the shape, right? A typical elongated hole is going to have these tangent radii. And in each of these examples, we're going to specify that as being capital R. And that just indicates that it's a full radius. We're going to get the dimension for that radius from somewhere else. Convention is to say 2 times and then R. And it's going to depend, the basic depends on what we're using to control it. So that'll change a little bit. But we typically don't give that its own dimension and tolerance. Now, there is a situation where maybe you have a radius that isn't a full radius. In that case, you would need to give, you know, indicate what the actual radius is and locate it. But we're not going to do that in this presentation. Okay. So the simplest possible way, I guess, is to just do plus or minus dimensions, right? I'm going to totally skip that, right? Use that at your own risk if you're putting that on a drawing. What I'm going to discuss are the GD&T techniques to indicate this on the drawing. The simplest method is to use profile. We're going to do all around. It's possible you could get away without the all around symbol. You know, I wouldn't, though. I would put it on there. It's more conventional to have this, you know, all around symbol, even though you can make an argument that this is not an abrupt change in the surface. So we're just going to leave it in there. We're locating it with basic dimensions from our datum reference frame, in this case, A, B, and C. Pretty straightforward there. And we're going to give the overall length of the slot and the overall height. So this is one of the three different ways to dimension a slot according to Y14.5. And of course, we've got our radius called out as basic here. Our tolerance zone for this, and I guess if I was slicker with PowerPoint, right, I could have this already like loaded up and have an overlay, but I'll just draw it, right? Whatever is on the drawing, this black line, this is our true profile, right? The center of our tolerance zone. Our actual profile is equal and bilateral. It's centered on there, and it's 20 thousandths. So we essentially have 10 thousandths on either side of where that's supposed to be. You can make that number larger or smaller, right? It just depends on the requirements. One thing to note about using profile is that you won't easily be able to use a gauge to measure this, because you're supposed to measure inside, right, of the material. Whereas a gauge, what do I mean by that? Say you have a hole and a part, right? When you gauge this imperfect hole, you're putting like a round thing in there and you're detecting these points, right? The points that touch it. I guess there's just two in this little example. What you can't detect with our gauge is this, like the magnitude of this. So basically the same thing with the slot, right? We can make sure the slot isn't too small, sort of, with the profile, but we couldn't verify anything else with it. So keep that in mind. Okay, the next thing we could do, if we needed that profile, and this is going to be a weird situation. So if you needed that slot to stay about the same, you know, shape and orientation to datum A, which is, in this case, I don't think I showed it on the first slide, just the backside of this part. You could have a looser tolerance for the location of that slot. So basically that slot could move up or down this distance, but it's still got to be, you know, the form of the slot has to be to this number. So if there's a mating part, you know, the slot kind of floats around, but that mating part will still, you know, go in as it should. You know, it depends what the slot is for. A lot of times a slot, right, you're just putting a screw in there. So, you know, maybe this could be helpful. It could make sure, you know, you're essentially controlling the slot itself to this number. It has some utility. The dimensioning scheme is the same, right? We've got this. Oh, and I didn't draw it, but if you had a pattern of slots for whatever reason, you could use this as well. And this would sort of be your only choice if you wanted to control that. Say you had a pattern of non-functional slots that are there for like cooling, like airflow or something. You could conceivably control them all as a pattern kind of together with composite profile. Okay. Now, this is a kind of weird one. This is using position and profile together. What's going on here, as you can imagine, right, you're going to control the form of that slot to the 60,000ths, right? So it's general kind of slot type shape. Right. I don't know how you do that on a surface plate, right, with manual stuff. I'm pretty sure you need a CMM, but maybe not. I don't know. I'd have to. It wouldn't be super easy. The reason being, you're locating it with this position tolerance. So what this creates, and I want to say it used to be required, did you write boundary under here? It creates a virtual condition, essentially. A virtual condition with that slot feature. So the way this works is you just take the position minus this profile, subtracted from your basic dimension, and that gives you that virtual condition boundary. And that lets you gauge this kind of feature. So you could have a slot shape set to this virtual condition that you get from this and drop the part on there and at least make sure, you know, that that works. And what I'm talking about here is about writing boundary. And I know this seems weird. Some of you that are familiar with the Y14 standards, you don't really need to do this anymore. But I was actually flipping through, I think it was Y14.41, the 3D mod, the MDB one, and it actually showed this as having boundary underneath this for a slot, which was weird. Okay, so what this does is create a virtual condition boundary, but instead of taking into account the previous example, let me show you right here. This profile is essentially your size tolerance, right? So you're essentially looking at a size of plus or minus 30. Here, our size is plus or minus 20. So it's a very similar kind of thing happening. I would argue that this method, people are gonna be more comfortable just measuring this straight up, just taking a pair of calipers to it or whatnot, whether right or wrong. So our virtual condition here is going to be whatever this number is minus our position, right? And that'll give us a virtual condition will look like this, right? And this is all supported in Y14.5. These ends, right, they're just full radii. They just get kind of tucked in there because when you're using the virtual condition, you're not having to like measure it per se, right? You just make sure the part fits over there. So I'd say this is, I didn't mention, you do not have to write boundary on here. You do need the all around symbol, but all this stays the same, right? You're just gonna take your virtual condition. Now, this applies when you need one tolerance for basically the length and the height. So you're controlling this and this with this 20,000ths. A lot of times with a slot, you only need to control, right, this up down part really tight, right, for the slot to kind of do its job, which is often just limiting rotation. So on the next slide, right, we can do that. And this is how you'll see it with position probably the most. we're going to have a larger tolerance on the kind of left-right part. And what that boils down to is your virtual condition is going to be smaller in the left and right. So your virtual condition boundary will be kind of pushed in. You know, this distance right here will be greater based on this number up here, this 0.06. So it'll allow a wider range of kind of slot sizes. Whereas this, the most important thing generally, we're going to control with this smaller number. So we've got a virtual condition here, right, that comes from over here, right, the vertical. And then we've got a virtual condition in the left right that comes from up here, right? So a pretty good way of doing it. I don't know if I mentioned it on the previous one. Notice how our R is no longer basic. The reason is our radii are no longer basic, right? It seems super minor, like whatever, who cares? But it could come up, right? If you make this basic and now you've got a UOS, like unless otherwise specified position in your title block, somebody might say, hey, you know, let's check this radius to this profile, right? When you want that radius, it's going to essentially get checked with this position up here. Okay. Here's something that's not explicit in Y14.5. So what if we just controlled the center plane of that feature? Now, in this case, I'm using regardless of feature size. And this is really what I wanted to, you know, make this video about, is not using regardless of feature size to control slots, except in a situation like this, where it's very clear that you're only using the position to control the center plane of this feature. Okay, so in this case, you're essentially ignoring that this thing has radii. So you're doing a very kind of normal thing. It's easy to extract the center plane from that feature. And you might say, okay, well, why? The reason is that we redid this a little bit and we're controlling the slot with a plus or minus dimension, right? So there's no geometric control over that left, right. And we're controlling the radius, if you notice it's not basic, with this number. Now, it should be much, much easier to check, right? It should encourage whoever's checking it, right? You basically got to put calipers here. And I know that's not ideal, but if it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter, right? You put calipers here, verify this number, verify this number. You come in with this radius, slap a radius gauge on it, right? Eyeball it with these giant tolerances I put on the drawing. And then for the position, grab your favorite, you know, 3/4 inch gauge block stack, you know, you stuff it in there and you can find the center of that without putting it on a coordinate measuring machine. So I'd see a lot of promise with this. Now, what you could also do is if this was at maximum material condition, now, so you didn't have a CMM, right? Or you didn't have a functional gauge for it. You could still check it with a gauge block. And now you could, you know, figure out where that gauge block is relative to where it's supposed to be, right? So say you measure the worst point on that gauge block and you get 1.03, right? So it's way higher than it needs to be relative to datum B. That would be outside of this, you know, 0.02. So this position of 1.02 is basically saying the center plane needs to be between these two numbers relative to down here. That makes sense. But with MMC, if our slot comes in at its largest size, its largest size, so let's say 0.77, we can get 40 thousandths additional or bonus tolerance. So now, whatever this is, 1.02, 1.06, now we'd be good, right? So it makes more sense. It could make more sense or just as much sense to use maximum material condition. Hopefully I didn't make any mental math errors there. I just kind of came up with that off the top of my head. Okay. In this next example, right, we're going to do it a little bit different. Say we're really following the 2018 revision. We don't want plus or minus dimensions locating anything. Well, now we'll go back to making these radii basic, but we're only going to control the center plane of this feature with position, whether it's RFS or at maximum material condition. Either one's fine. What happens here is these radii are going to get picked up by our unless otherwise specified profile, right? So we're going to have a tolerance zone kind of like this for a radii, right? And that'll get checked separately, right? Because profile and position are like a totally different thing from our position. Our position tolerance zone is inside, right? And we're trying to find, you know, the unrelated actual mating envelope of that feature. Whereas a profile, we're looking for the actual surface. So they're two very different things. This method, if you are, did I forget this? Oh, that's just an extra dimension. Yeah, ignore that. If you are using 2018, this is one way you could do it. Again, you could just go back to using the position with the boundary. The advantage, again, with this position is that you could measure it without gauging, right? Because you're just measuring that center plane. It's something that's reasonable enough to measure there. So yeah, that's it for this presentation. I'm trying out this new setup for recorded videos. I've been using it for live streams, but let me know in the comments if it works for you. Let me know whatever topic you want to see next, and I'll try to cover it. So if you enjoyed the video, please like, subscribe, and leave a comment down below.